Good morning and welcome everyone to this time of worship at ANZA United Church in Markville, Ontario, whether you're in person via live stream or at some other time from our recorded service from our website, know that you are all welcome here. My name is Dale Beare, and with us again today are Phyllis Fleming and her wife, Reverend Thérèse Samuel. So welcome back. Good to see you both. Their home church is Grace United in Thornbury. Brenda Dimoff and the choir will be leading us providing musical leadership this morning, and Ron Wyvill will be reading the scriptures. I also want to acknowledge our excellent technical team, led by Tim Riley and assisted this morning by Stacy Hiltz. We are grateful for each one who offers their gifts whenever they can and in whatever way they can. Now, there are several announcements in the bulletin. I'm just going to highlight a few. Gray Highland still standing, remaining upright. A year in review on Saturday, February 17th at 7 p.m. here at Ansley. In the vein of CBC still standing, a fun look back on the past year in Gray Highlands. It's free admission, donations accepted, food and refreshments are available, and it's presented by Ansley Events. Broadview magazine subscriptions are due in March 2024, and they're still $30, and payment can be dropped off with Patty at the office or mailed to ANZA United Church, Post Office Box 573, Markdale, Ontario, N0C1H0, or on the collection plate marked Broadview. New subscriptions are always welcome. The Ansley Quilt Makers are having their next quilting day on Wednesday, February 21st from 9:30 to 2:30 in the Fellowship Hall. Please bring your own lunch. We will provide tea and coffee. The next order date for Funscript is Sunday, February 25th. February promotions include Foodland, Fresco IGA, Sobeys, which offer a 5% return on that, and Banana Republic or Gap or Old Navy at 9%. So if you haven't tried Funscript, it's a very easy fellowship or a very easy fundraiser. And if you have any questions, please see me or Patty. The Nitwits are also meeting tomorrow at 1:30 to 3:30 p.m. Now I invite you to prepare yourself for worship by taking a few deeper breaths and centering yourself as we listen to this offering of music by Brenda.
Thank you, Brenda. Good morning. Good morning, whether you're here in the sanctuary, and good morning to everyone who's joining us online, either right now or later on YouTube. Thank you for welcoming once more to the pulpit of Ansley United Church. Let us begin by acknowledging where we are. Here in the sanctuary of Ansley United Church in Markdale, Ontario, we acknowledge with gratitude that we gather on the traditional territory of the Anishinaabeg Nation, the people of the Three Fires known as Ojibwe, Odawa, and Potawatomi Nations, and also the traditional territory of the Petun, Huron-Wendat, and Mississauga peoples. This territory is covered by Treaty 18 of 1818, and we are all treaty people. In the spirit of reconciliation, let us commit together as settlers and First Peoples to work toward right relations with each other. In this way, we will follow Jesus' commandment to love our neighbors as ourselves. Jesus also commands us to let our light shine before others. We light the Christ candle to symbolize the light of Christ that burns in all of us. Our call to worship is responsive. Who is Jesus for us? The continuation of the covenant, the promise of something new, the presence of God's love. Who are we for him? The continuation of the covenant, the promise of something new, the presence of God's love. In God's love, he was changed, transfigured, and transformed. In God's love, we are changed, given hope, made new. As people changed and changing, as disciples of Christ, as followers of Jesus' way, we worship God. And we pray together, God of power and wonder, we are awestruck by the glory of your presence. We rejoice at what we can see. We marvel at what we cannot see. You dazzle us with your brightness. You overshadow us as with a great cloud. Loving, protecting, challenging, nurturing, you strengthen and transform us. May we love and serve you in all that we are and do. Glory be to you. Amen. Our opening hymn this morning is Songs of Thankfulness and Praise, Voices United 101.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Well, good morning there. I've got a story to read, but first of all, your Sunday school teacher has something to tell everybody.
Hi there. Nice to see y'all. It's good to have you here. This morning, when we go to Sunday school, Hazel and I will be helping to make a beautiful poster to show all the congregation, and then we're going to hand out treats to them after the service. Okay? So make sure you stop, everybody, just outside the double doors and greet the lovely children and receive your gift.
Thanks, Stella. So this is one of the stories that we're going to be talking about in the church today while you're off at Sunday school. And you'll see there's a picture here with a bunch of people. And you'll find out who they are. So Jesus said to his closest friends, Peter and James and John, "Come with me to the mountaintop to pray." They climbed for hours until their legs ached. At last, they were at the top. Jesus' face began to shine with a light as bright as the sun, and his clothes seemed to glow. Moses and Elijah, two great leaders who had died long ago, appeared next to Jesus and began to talk with him. Peter and his friends were stunned. "Lord," Peter gasped, "we are blessed to be here. Let me build houses and we can stay in this wonderful place forever." But even as he was speaking, a bright cloud came down and covered them all. A voice spoke from the cloud, "This is my son who fills me with joy. I love him. Listen to what he says." That was the voice of God. Wow, surprising. Peter, James, and John covered their heads and threw themselves on the ground in fear. Jesus touched them gently on the shoulder. The cloud had gone, and Jesus was alone with them. "We cannot stay on the mountaintop," Jesus said. "We must return to the valley where God's children need us." So there's all those people in the story, in this picture. And so I'm going to invite you to pray with me. Just repeat after me. Dear God, help me to share your glory with others. Amen. And we continue to pray in the words that Jesus taught his followers to pray, and they're up on the screen there. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Well, thank you for listening to my story, and I hope you have a wonderful time in Sunday school. And we'll see you after the service. Let us pray together our prayer of confession. We come now, loving God, ready to be transformed and transfigured. We are ready to experience how your love can change us, our beings, our lives, and our world. Open each one of us this day to the power of your love. May we be infused with its fullness and filled with its potential. As we come to fully know you and your love, we also come with a sense of guilt, for we have not always loved as you love us. We have ignored moments of potential and searched for failure. Sometimes we have moved away from love and been drawn in by hate. We have forgotten how much you love us and have been swallowed by self-loathing. Forgive our foolish ways. Once again, draw us deeper into your love and bring us to wholeness and life in your love. Amen. Friends, the good news is for us all. The wonder of God's love is forgiveness for all, over and over again. The wonder of God's forgiveness is the opportunity for all of us to have a fresh start, ready to share the wonderful love and forgiveness of God. Thanks be to God. And as we prepare to listen to words from Scripture, let us pray together. God, speak your word of transformation through stories recorded long ago. Help us to understand what these stories can tell us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Our scripture reading this morning is from 2 Kings chapter 2, verses 1 to 12, Psalm 50, 1 to 6, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, and Mark chapter 9. First of all, from 2 Kings, and this reading, by the way, is from the Message Bible. And there are two men in this reading, Elijah and Elisha. They are both men, even though the second one sounds a little bit like a woman. Just before God took Elijah into heaven in a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on a walk out of Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here. God has sent me on an errand to Bethel." Elisha said, "Not on your life. I'm not letting you go out of my sight." So they both went to Bethel. The guild of prophets at Bethel met Elisha and said, "Do you know that God is going to take your master away from you today?" "Yes," he said, "I know it, but keep it quiet." Then Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here. God has sent me on an errand to Jericho." Elisha said, "Not on your life. I'm not letting you out of my sight." So they both went to Jericho. The guild of prophets at Jericho came to Elisha and said, "Did you know that God is going to take your master away from you today?" "Yes," he said, "I know it, but keep it quiet." Then Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here. God has sent me on an errand to the Jordan." Elisha said, "Not on your life. I'm not letting you out of my sight." And so the two of them went their way together. Meanwhile, 50 men from the guild of prophets gathered some distance away while the two of them stood at the Jordan. Elijah took his cloak, rolled it up, and hit the water with it. The river divided, and the two men walked through on dry land. When they reached the other side, Elijah said to Elisha, "What can I do for you before I'm taken from you?" "Ask anything," Elisha said, "Your life repeated in my life. I want to be a holy man just like you." "That's a hard one," said Elisha. "But if you're watching when I'm taken from you, you'll get what you ask for. But only if you're watching." And so it happened. They were walking along and talking. Suddenly, a chariot and horses of fire came between them, and Elijah went up in a whirlwind to heaven. Elisha saw it and shouted, "My father, my father, you, the chariot and cavalry of Israel." When he could no longer see anything, he grabbed his robe and ripped it to shreds. Now from Psalms 50, verses 1 to 6. The Almighty has spoken. God shines out from Zion, a city perfect in beauty. Before you, God, runs a consuming fire, and a mighty tempest rages about you.
To witness the judgment of your people.
Gather my people before me, the people who made covenant with me by sacrifice. Now from 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 3 to 6. And this reading is from the Message Bible. If our message is to obscure to anyone, if our message is obscure to anyone, this is not because we're holding back in any way. No, it's because these other people are looking or going the wrong way and refuse to give it serious attention. All they have eyes for is the fashionable god of darkness. They think he can give them what they want and that they won't have to bother really believing a truth they can't see. They're stone blind to the dayspring brightness of the message that shines with Christ, who gives us the best picture of God we'll ever get. Remember, our message is not about ourselves. We're proclaiming Jesus Christ the Master. All we are is messengers, errant runners from Jesus for you. It started when God said, "Light up the darkness," and our lives filled up with light as we saw and understood God in the face of Christ, all bright and beautiful. And now from Mark chapter 9, verses 2 to 9. This reading is from the New Revised Standard Version. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them. And his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, for they were terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice. This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him. Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. And they were coming down the mountain. He ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen until after the Son of Man had risen from the dead. Words and stories from our Judeo-Christian tradition that are entrusted to us in our time and place. Thanks be to God.
Please pray with me. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Today is Transfiguration Sunday, the last Sunday before Lent begins. Does anyone here give up things for Lent? Show of hands? Yeah. Does anyone give up chocolate for Lent? Well, if you do, I have some bad news for you. Because the first day of Lent is this Wednesday, which is also something else. Yep, Valentine's Day. So if you get a big box of chocolates as a Valentine's present, and you're giving up chocolate for Lent, what are you going to do?
Broccoli instead.
Oh. Oh, Peter, he's going to give up broccoli instead. Yeah. Or you could share the box of chocolates. And every Sunday in Lent is a little Easter. So if you give up anything for Lent, you can always do that thing on every Sunday. Because each Sunday is a celebration of the resurrection. I used to give up chocolate for Lent because I love it so much, it was a real sacrifice. But I don't do that anymore. Instead, when I do eat chocolate during Lent, I am very mindful that I am doing that. Eating chocolate actually becomes a spiritual practice that helps me remember that we're in Lent. But today we aren't in Lent yet. We are at the end of the season of Epiphany. Epiphany celebrated the arrival of the Magi who had followed a star to bring gifts to the child born in a manger and worshipped him. The important thing is that they had followed the star, and this star has shone through the season of Epiphany. And this year, thanks to Reverend Christine, you have received star words to contemplate through the year. If you missed that, you can visit the office to get one at any time during church, during office hours. As we remember that the light of the star is what led the Magi to Jesus, we find that all of the scripture readings from this morning involve light in some way. I think the most striking ones are the Old Testament lesson and the gospel lesson. In the reading from 2 Kings, we heard the story of how Elisha went with Elijah when Elijah was about to be taken up to heaven, as we heard at the beginning of this passage. A while before this, Elijah had become very discouraged about being a prophet, especially after he made an enemy of the king of Israel, who then wanted to kill him. Elijah had run away to Mount Horeb, and there he encountered God in a still, small voice. Elijah told God that he was the only prophet left and that the Israelites were trying to kill him. In response, God told him to anoint Elisha to succeed him as prophet. In other words, God called Elisha to be Elijah's disciple. Today's story is about Elijah and Elisha's last day together, which they spent walking from place to place, as you heard. When they reached Elijah's final destination, the far side of the Jordan River, he somehow knew that he was about to be taken up into heaven, and so he offered to do anything Elisha wanted before he left. Elisha asked to be a holy man just like him, a prophet. Elijah said that it would happen, but only if Elisha saw him being taken away. You'll remember the story of the burning bush, where Moses saw a bush that was on fire but wasn't consumed, and the voice of God spoke to him from the bush. Fire is a symbol of God's presence, and Elisha was able to look at the chariot of fire and the horses of fire that took Elijah away. I think that the light of the fire showed Elisha that his request to Elijah had come true. He had been transformed from disciple to prophet. Since Epiphany at the beginning of January, the gospel readings in the lectionary each week have given us a whirlwind tour through the first part of Jesus' ministry, starting from his baptism and ending with the Transfiguration, right before he started journeying toward Jerusalem, where he would be put to death on a Roman cross. 6 days before the story in today's passage, Jesus had told the disciples for the first time that he would need to suffer and be killed and then rise again after 3 days. Peter was upset by this and rebuked Jesus for saying these things, but Jesus said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You have no idea how God works." I think all of the disciples must have been still upset and talking about this 6 days later, when Jesus took Peter, James, and John with him up a high mountain. Up there on the mountain, away from the rest of the disciples, Jesus was transformed in front of Peter, James, and John, and his clothes became dazzling white. And if that wasn't surprising enough, the next thing that happened was that Moses and Elijah appeared talking with Jesus. Those two represented the holy writings of Israel. Moses represented the law, think of the Ten Commandments, and Elijah represented the prophets. Elijah was considered to be the greatest prophet, and since that tradition says that he was taken up into heaven alive, he was expected to reappear on earth before the Messiah appeared. In fact, for centuries, Jewish people had been setting an extra cup of wine on the dinner table for Elijah at Passover and opening the door for him, hoping that he will enter. Jesus was able to bring the law and the prophets together in his teaching about God's kingdom. And Moses and Elijah talking with Jesus would signify the high spiritual status of Jesus. The final surprise for the three disciples was yet to come. A cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice. "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." I think this is the only time in the Gospels that God speaks directly to the followers of Jesus. There are lots of signs and signals from God. A star, a dove, an empty tomb. But here God speaks, and God says the same thing that God told Jesus at his baptism. "You are my son, the beloved." Since Jesus wasn't speaking to the disciples when God said, "Listen to him," it's likely that God meant for them to pay attention to what Jesus was saying about his death and resurrection. The next moment, the cloud and Moses and Elijah were gone, and only Jesus was there with them, assumably with his appearance returned to normal as they went back down the mountain to resume their regular lives. Elijah was transformed as he was swept up into heaven by the horses of fire and chariots of fire, and Elisha was also transformed. He went from being Elijah's attendant to being the next great prophet. Jesus was transfigured in front of the three disciples, and I think they really did see him in a new light. Another way of saying this is that his disciples were able to finally, if briefly, see him for who he truly was. Jesus' disciples were also transformed. I don't expect to see a chariot of fire or horses of fire these days, or to hear about someone seeing Moses and Elijah. But I know that it's possible for the love of God and the light of Christ to transform people and situations for us, and for us to be transformed. Here's an example from my own life. A number of years ago, I met a man who was one of those real jokesters. It felt like he never said anything serious and that he was always teasing me about something. I thought he was pretty shallow and didn't really like him much. However, I had to work with him, so I made the best of it. One day, though, we were talking about a social justice issue, and he said something that at first I thought was just him being sarcastic. But something made me realize that he was serious, and I discovered that he was concerned about many of the same issues I was concerned about. He had taken the risk to show another side of himself. I saw how God was working in his life, and he was transformed for me from a shallow jokester. He was transformed from a shallow jokester to someone I knew I could have a deep spiritual conversation with. I believe that the light of Christ showed me this man's true character, and the way I saw him was transformed. The story of the Transfiguration reminds us that Jesus is far more than he first appears. And only when we catch a glimpse of who he really is, it bewilders and amazes and, yes, confuses us. But the light of Jesus shines through scriptures, prayers, and hymns to help us understand, and recognizing that we are amazed and bewildered and confused may give us the nudge we need to really think about what Jesus teaches us and calls us to do. For instance, what situations might be transformed for us if we look at them in a new light, the light of Christ's presence shown in the love of God? Whose reputation might be transformed for us if we look at them in a new light, the light of Christ's presence shown in the love of God? How might Ann's Lee United Church transform itself to shine the light of Christ, the light of God's love, into the community and beyond? May the symbol of light from the Epiphany Star explode with joy in our hearts as we find ways that we can transform and be transformed. Let's pray. O God, thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, the light of the world. We see your glory reflected in the story of the Transfiguration and also in all life around us. Help us to respond to that glory by bringing your love more fully into the world. In the name of Jesus the Christ we pray. Amen. And we sing about this in Voices United 103, How Good Lord to Be Here.
Thank you.
Let us pray. God, whose glory the heavens are telling, we praise you for light leaping across northern skies, and for the joys of blade upon ice, ski upon snow, fire in the hearth, and friends for celebration. We praise you also for your continuing presence in a world where wealth has so much say, and the wicked prosper, and relationships go sour, and hearts and dreams are broken. In laughter and tears alike, we praise you. We pray for those who make decisions about the resources of the earth, that we may use your gifts responsibly. For those who work on the land and sea, in city and in industry. For those who work for those who work on the land and sea, in city and in industry, that all may enjoy the fruits of their labors and marvel at your creation. For artists, scientists, and visionaries, that through their work we may see creation afresh. We thank you for giving us life. For all who enrich our experience, we pray for all who through their own or others' actions are deprived of fullness of life, for the citizens of Ukraine, Israel, and especially the city of Rafah in Gaza, whose lives are affected directly by war, for prisoners, refugees, and all who are sick, for those in politics, medical science, social and relief work, and for your church, for all who seek to bring life to others. We thank you that you have called us to celebrate your creation. Give us reverence for life in your world. We thank you for your redeeming love. May your word and sacrament strengthen us to love as you love us. God, our Creator, bring us new life. Jesus, Redeemer, renew us. Holy Spirit, strengthen and guide us. Amen. And now we'll have some special music recorded by Brenda and Peter.
Wish you could ever be is waiting to find you.
Thank you for sharing that music with us. Our story this morning for Your Generosity Matters is it's related to the fact that we are in Black History Month. It's called Lessons of Racism Learned When Young. The following is an excerpt from a blog written by Adele Halliday. Your mission and service gifts support anti-racism programs and initiatives like the ones Halliday develops as the United Church's anti-racism and equity lead to help all of us be in deeper, more equitable relationships with one another. I am speaking Adele's words. The name calling started when she was about 3 years old. They were racial slurs and names and taunts. My child, my own flesh and blood, was being ostracized for having black skin. The people slinging the insults? Other children on the playground. She may not necessarily have always understood the particular terms that they used, but she knew that they were related to her blackness and her racial identity, and this deeply wounded her tender heart. Despite all of our intentional modeling, teaching, and proactive actions, our child is still already developing internalized racism and inferior notions of herself. The children who taunted her were offering explicit and overt notions of racism, but they were children. They hadn't even started primary school. And yet, the children had already learned behaviors at home or elsewhere in society that whiteness is superior. And they had the audacity to vocalize that to an innocent little child. Children as young as three, of course, already naturally notice differences, including racial differences. But they are far too young to understand assigning negative values to those racial differences, unless that is taught to them. Whether that is taught explicitly or implicitly, those messages are being learned. That is in part why I am so deeply committed to dismantling racism in all its forms. Racism is damaging and destructive to all people in society. It reinforces negative notions for people of color. I live it in a particular way because of my own racial identity as a black person who has lived with racial injustice my entire life. The systemic nature of racism is something that cannot be ignored. This effort to overcome racism is a continuous effort, and I am committed to this work for the long haul. I hope that you will be too. The words of Adele Halliday. While our hearts and minds may be transformed by sacred stories, wise words, or beautiful music during worship, it is through sharing generously that we are releasing our gifts into the world to transform others. We give with the prayer that our generosity will not only help us feel connected to God, but our gifts will transform and transfigure, flowing through our faith community and into the world to prepare the way for God's kingdom. Let us think about what we share. And we'll sing together our hymn of dedication, Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Generous God, transform what we offer this morning for your work in this world. Transfigure us in our giving that we might know your joyful spirit through the spiritual practice of committed offerings. Inspire us to live into your abundance in Jesus' strong name. Amen. And as we prepare to end this time of worship, we sing Christ Whose Glory Fills the Skies, Voices United 336. People blessed by God, for those who have seen the transfigured Christ are blessed in order to be a blessing in this world. We are transformed people. Go in the light of the transfigured Christ as you leave this place, taking the blessing and love of Christ out into the world. And may the everlasting love of God, who calls us to listen to Jesus, be with you. May the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, whose love can transform us, be with you. And may the comfort of the Holy Spirit be with you as you leave this time of worship, whether in person or online. May it be so. Amen.